Please make a private examination of your conscience. And may we now recite the Confiti here together. I confess to Almighty God, one and all Trinity, who knows the innermost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my own great fault. In your presence, O God, I publicly express sorrow for the many sins by which I have offended you. I resolve to amend my life, to improve and sanctify it, endeavoring henceforth to serve you faithfully all the days of my life. I ask all those who dwell within the Church of Christ, the Blessed Mother Mary, Holy Apostles, Martyrs, and Faithful, who have lived, suffered, and died for the gospel of Jesus Christ, as well as you, my brothers and sisters, to witness my confession, and pray for me to our Lord God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May the Almighty and Merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins. May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Show us your mercy, Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Grant, most gracious Father, that of purity of heart, we may worthily fulfill this holy action, established to remembrance of the Last Supper and the death of Jesus Christ, and for our sanctification and salvation. Be present among us, Jesus, our most perfect Master, because you said that where two or three are gathered together in my name, you are among them. We also ask, Lord, that through this holy liturgy, we may experience a spiritual revival and a better understanding of your holy will, bringing us together in one great family, guided by your commandments, and by truth, or by love, truth, and justice. And may we say so. Let us praise the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, invisible, revealed in triune power, for all time, now, and forever. Glory to God in the highest, and peace with people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, Holy Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayers. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, and the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God our Father, your Son called us to be evangelists for your kingdom and bearers of your good news to all the world. Renew the spirit of faith and service that is in us, that our witness may turn many to your light and to your peace. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen. The lesson prescribed by the Church for this morning's Holy Mass is taken from St. Paul's first epistle to the Corinthians. Now I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you should be in agreement and that there should be no division among you, but that you should be united in the same mind and the same purpose. For it has been reported to me by Chloe's people that there are quarrels among you, my brothers and sisters. What I mean is that each of you says, I belong to Paul, or I belong to Apollos, or I belong to Cephas, or I belong to Christ. Has Christ been divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to proclaim the gospel, and not with eloquent wisdom, so that the cross of Christ might not be emptied of its power. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The poor will eat their fill. Those who seek the Lord will offer praise. May your hearts enjoy life forever.
Amen.
Amen.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord has done great things for us, and we rejoice.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God. You cleansed the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. In your mercy, cleanse me so I may worthy proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthy proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew. When Jesus heard that John the Baptist had been arrested, he withdrew back to Galilee. He left Nazareth and went to live in Capernaum by the sea, in the region of Zebulun and Naphtali, that what had been said through Isaiah the prophet may be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, the way to the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who sit in darkness have seen a great light. On those dwelling in a land overshadowed by death, light has arisen. And from that time on, Jesus began to preach and to say, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand." And as he was walking by the Sea of Galilee, Jesus saw two brothers, Simon, who was called Peter, and his brother Andrew, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Come after me, and I will make you fishers of men." At once they left their nets and followed him. He walked along from there and saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They were in a boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets. He called them as well, and immediately they left their boat and their father, and they followed Jesus. And he went around all of Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom, and curing every disease and illness among the people. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Gentiles means as non-Jews. And the ones who came before him started to resent his success and the change that he was forcing upon them. They were very comfortable the way they were, and Paul is changing that, and you know that means tension. So the church was starting to look different. The church was starting to sound different. The church was starting to believe differently. And they wanted Paul, because of this, to make his converts and his church more like theirs by worshiping Jesus, of course, but also by keeping some of the Jewish traditions. their Jewish traditions. Paul outright refused, and obviously his example won because the Christianity that we practice today is Paul's Christianity. We don't keep the Jewish traditions. Paul's example won the day, and we are Paul's church. But Paul was very concerned about maintaining the unity of the church. And so he sat down with these others, and the others who were in powers or in positions of power, they were willing to sit down with him, and they didn't have to, but they did. And they came to an agreement. Paul would continue his ministry unchanged, but he was asked to help the church in Jerusalem by accepting a monetary collection wherever he went. For you see, the Jerusalem church imitated the example of Jesus' lifestyle. They owned nothing individually. They pooled everything that they owned into a community treasury. If we were the Jerusalem church, we would not have a Randy Calvo bank account. We would not have a Karen Ditch bank account. We would not have a Mark Stahelski bank account. We would take everything that we owned, our cars, our homes, our property, everything we owned, we put into a holy name of Jesus account. And then we would live off of that account together. That's called today communism, a commune maybe, like out in Israel they have communes, or back in the 60s they had communes. That was what the Jerusalem church was. And you know that you don't make a lot of money that way. And so these people in the Jerusalem community, they were impoverished. And so just like Jesus traveled from here to there, he didn't care about food, he didn't care about clothing, he didn't worry about shelter, he just knew that these things would be provided. Well, neither did the church in Jerusalem, and they were poor. But their example was considered to be so important for the rest of the church that the rest of the church was supposed to help them keep this living example of the way that Jesus lived. And this Paul was willing to do with his collections in every single city that he went to. Now, this is an extremely important example of what Paul means when he says to the Corinthians that they have to be in agreement, that there be no divisions among them. Paul, even though he said that, Paul remained different, defiantly different. That never changed throughout his ministry, but different to him, and this is important, did not have to mean division. Take, for example, the quick mention today of Chloe's people. Chloe is a woman's name. And Chloe's people means that Chloe was one of the leaders in one of the churches in Corinth. And there is probably no way that any earlier church leader before Paul would ever have allowed something as scandalous as this to happen, to have a woman be a leader of a church. But in Paul's churches, it's mentioned without any other further comment. It just wasn't extraordinary. It wasn't something out of the ordinary. And for Paul, this is what was the normal in his different kind of church. And this is the Paul who also told the Galatian community that there is no male nor female. That does not matter. What matters to me in Christ is the Spirit. So differences are real, he says, but division does not have to flow from them. And that, I really think, is a lesson we need to think about, and that maybe we need to take out of this place and out into our world. That differences are real, but division doesn't have to flow from it. Paul doesn't hide his head in the sand and act like differences aren't there, that they don't matter. People can be passionate. Think about all the people who went to Washington for the inauguration. They were passionate about what they believed. Think about all the people who went the next day to the Women's March in Washington. They were passionate about what they believed, but the people there on Friday, the people there on Saturday, they're all Americans. We have to learn that difference doesn't have to mean division. So he reminds the Corinthians that there is something far greater than that which would try to separate them, and that is their shared faith in Jesus. That which holds them together is far more important than that which would try to separate them. That is a message that is really worth listening to and maybe living. Just like Paul had sat down with the others, and the others were willing to sit down with Paul so that different churches would stay united with his older Jerusalem church, Paul is challenging the Christians in Corinth to do the exact same thing, to sit down with each other. You guys, he says in Corinth, you have different beliefs, but just sit down with each other. You all think differently, you're all acting differently, but sit down together and talk this out. And he's basically telling them, try to figure out how you all fit together in some kind of a mosaic, some kind of those pieces of puzzle. See how you come together as church, because community is more important than uniformity. And he reminds them that no one was baptized in his name, no one was baptized in Apollos' name, no one was baptized in Peter's name. They are all baptized in Jesus' name. And the message is to look past the differences and to seek out the greater unity. Our faith overflows with the message that we need to not only look for the difference, maybe accept the difference, but that we have to embrace the difference. Think about Paul again. His idea of church is the church that we live today, but in his day, he was the different church, and he caused a lot of trouble by being the different church. And even though his pedigree wasn't as convincing as Peter's, one of those first followers of Jesus that we just heard about today, or even James, who, by the way, was the head of that Jerusalem church, he was called in the New Testament the brother of Jesus. He's also never one of the 12 apostles, but he was the head of that first biggest church, the Jerusalem church. But nonetheless, Paul's idea of church, even though Peter's was different, even though James's was different, it's Paul's idea of church that we follow today. Or think about Jesus walking along the shore of the Sea of Galilee. What if those first four apostles, what if they chose to just keep on going fishing? What if they would not listen to the new and different message of Jesus? Then what would have happened? If none of them had listened, how would we hear today? Or remember that today's gospel closes with the announcement that Jesus begins to travel throughout Galilee, proclaiming his new and different gospel. It was only the ones who could listen to the different. They all didn't accept, but it was only the ones who could at least listen to the different that ever had a chance of coming to Christ. And it was because of this tradition of difference that the church could grow as a community of really different people who were held together by a really different Savior. Savior who looked past those things that would try to keep people separated and who instead emphasized how we can come together, differences and all, but not division. Now maybe this may be this hard job of looking past the differences and not seeing division. This may be the really hard job of church in today's world. This may be the task of Christians in today's society. Maybe we're being called upon to speak and to live this message of a community that is even stronger than our differences, no matter how passionately held. Maybe we have to be another kind of different so that we can interrupt the voices that want to pull us apart. Maybe we can then share Paul's message once again that difference doesn't have to mean division. I hope we can pray this together as a society, as a nation, as a society of nations, so we can always do our best to come together as one community under one God up in heaven. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty Lord, as we gather on this day where we continue to celebrate the Nativity and the Incarnation of our Lord, we also pray at this time we offer a happy 90th birthday to Colonel Helen Maslanka, retired United States Air Force, and this is offered by the Massey, Maslanka, and Delhausen families. We also offer our prayers still this week for the recovery of Jenny DeMera, who was operated on and is now going through rehabilitation, and who I heard from her daughter, will hopefully return back home next weekend, so we keep Jenny in our prayers as well. I offer prayers for Donald Lieski, 59 years old, who was a fellow altar boy with me back at St. Joseph's in Westfield. He died last weekend in a car accident. He is also the uncle of Cindy Lieski Keys, right here in our parish. We offer our prayers for Donald and also for his family that is grieving. We also continue to offer our prayers for the fallen who are battling cancer. Meg Connors by Ellen and Don Sprosky. Randy Clemens by her grandmother Dottie Baronis. Fathers Ray Drada and Maurice Lazelle is offered by myself. Richard Poe is offered by the Poe and Foster families. 2-year-old Jack Seela is offered by Marianne Foster. Also Alex, who is 16 years old, battling lymphoma, Hodgkin's disease. Alicia, a young mother of three with stage 4 breast cancer, and Liz Bridgman, raising 3 young girls on her own, and all 3 of those intentions are offered by Cindy Benjamin. We also offer our prayers at this time for Frank Sprosky, as offered by the Sprosky, Gates, and Kirkendall families. Are there any intentions you would like to offer from the congregation? Yes.
Father, for the families of the tragic accident in Springfield, I guess, cathedral students were killed in a car accident, I believe, the night before last.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
Four students, and so.
So they're like
18?
18 years?
Okay. Yeah, all seniors.
Okay, so seniors from Cathedral High School in Springfield. Sure, we'll offer a prayer for that. All set. For all of these intentions, Lord, bless the private ones that we keep in our thoughts and bring before you at this time. We also ask you, Lord, to bless all of us here gathered, and be with those of our parish who are unable to be with us here today, and of course, those of our parish who have chosen not to be with us here today. And for these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread.
And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord. May they rest in peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us our salvation. Down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, with the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray.
Turn back, you sinners. Do the right before God. Perhaps he may look with favor upon you and show you mercy. We receive from your most sacred hands, most gracious Father, the sacramental bread with the same faith as
Thank you.
may be accepted to God, the Almighty Father. Amen. Heavenly Father, accept this offering and grant to us and to your church worldwide the grace to engage in a bold and a daring evangelism. May we who attempt great things for you also expect to receive great things from you. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Jesus Christ our Lord. You sent us Jesus Christ, who conceived by the Holy Spirit, was born of the Virgin Mother, Mary most holy. We have come to know and love you as our perfect Father through the revealed mystery of your incarnate Word. We praise you, Father, and through your Son now made visible, long to be with you, our unseen God. Therefore the angels and archangels, with all the saints and the entire church, we lift our hymn of praise to your glory, repeating unceasingly. Holy, 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 God, our Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We therefore, most merciful Father, Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, most humbly beseech you to accept and to bless these gifts, these presents, these holy unspotted sacrifices, which your holy church receives from you, employing you to defend and guide her throughout the world, together with her priests and all true believers of the holy faith. Remember, Lord, your servants. Congregation, imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule, and fatherly love. Wholeheartedly this day, we unite in spirit with all of those, beginning the most blessed Mother Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise his apostles, with all the countless hosts of martyrs and confessors who lived, labored, and suffered for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life and his most precious blood. Just as they believed, professed, and united with you through prayer and this immaculate oblation, which you have instituted at the beginning of the world, and in time have fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation. So we too this day profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hands this holy bread and this precious chalice as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world as spiritual food and drink. He promised us this food and drink in that moment when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread, and feeding with it a hungry multitude of people. Afterward, he foretold the giving of that food and drink to his disciples and friends as a more excellent nourishment when he said, "It is my Father who gives you the real heavenly bread. I myself am the living bread come down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. The bread I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." And afterwards, when the temporal and messianic life of the divine teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all those who had loved in a singular way and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. "I will not leave you orphaned. I will come back to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not be distressed or fearful. You will suffer in the world, but take courage. I have overcome the world. If you live in me and my words stay a part of you, you may ask what you will and it will be done for you. Anyone who loves me will be true to my word, and my Father will love him. We will come to him and make our dwelling place with him. I consecrate myself for their sakes now, that they may be consecrated in truth, that all may be one, as you, Father, are in me and I in you. I pray that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I living in them, you living in me, that their unity may be made complete. Father, all those you gave me, I would have in my company where I am to see this glory of mine, which is your gift to me, because of the love you bore me before the world began. I myself am the bread of life. No one who comes to me will ever be hungry. No one who believes in me shall ever thirst. After these and other words of the archpriest in prayer and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which is given for you. In like manner after supper, taking this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which shall be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Wherefore, mindful Lord, we your servants and your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as well as his blessed passion, resurrection, and his glorious ascension, we receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance, as from him who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, and with an unshakable faith that they will become for our souls a saving remedy. We humbly ask you, Almighty God, to command that our offering be brought by the hands of your holy angel to your highest altar into the presence of your divine majesty. That we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son from this altar may be filled with every blessing and grace through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and who have passed on to eternity. To these souls, Lord, and to all who rest in Christ, grant everlasting life. And to those who during life stray from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their suffering. We ask this in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs and all your saints, who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts are always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after their divine master, merited eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. But whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray, instructed by our Savior's teaching and following divine example, we say with confidence. intercession of the blessed and glorious Mother of God Mary, together with your blessed apostles Peter and Paul, as also Andrew and all the saints, grant us peace in our days, supported by the help of your mercy, that we always be free from sin and secure from all disturbance. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. May the peace of the Lord be with you always. May the union of divinity and humanity in Jesus Christ bring us sanctification and eternal life. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Do not look at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace of the unity of your kingdom. You live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching, and never let me be parted from you, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. May the partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be cause for my judgment. Though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, through your loving kindness may become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving master awaken in me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May the last unite me entirely with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this who lives, reigns with God the Father, in unity with the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. What shall I return to the Lord for all the graces that he has rendered unto me? I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord, and I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy to see you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. The body of the Lord Christ. The body of the Lord Christ. Body and the blood of Christ.
body and the blood of Christ.
By the power of your holy word and the power of the Holy Eucharist, Cleanse us from indifference and fill us with zeal that we may bring others to a knowledge and a love of you. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Be with you.
And also with you.
Oh, the sacrifice is offered.
Thanks be to God.
May the tribute of our worship be pleasing to you, most holy Trinity. Grant that the sacrifice which I, though unworthy, have offered in the sight of your majesty be acceptable to you. Through your mercy may be effective for myself and all of those for whom I have offered it, through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was in God's presence, and the Word was God. He was present to God in the beginning. Through him all things came into being, and apart from him nothing came to be. Whatever came to be in him found light, light for the light of men. The light shines on in darkness, a darkness that did not overcome it. There was a man named John sent by God, who came as a witness to testify to the light, so that through him all might believe, but only to testify to the light, for he himself was not the light. The real light which gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and through him the world was made, yet the world did not know who he was. To his own he came, and his own did not accept him. Any who did accept him, he empowered to become children of God. These are they who believe in his name, who were begotten not by blood, nor by carnal desire, nor by man's willingness, but by God. And the Word became flesh, and dwelt in and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of his only Son, coming from the Father, filled with enduring love.